Watching. This is the regular meeting of the May 8, 2000, of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. May I have a roll call, please?
Chairman Carson.
Here.
Counselor Barry.
Present.
Counselor Fritz.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
Counselor Roberts. Counselor Swift Kayata.
Here.
Counselor Watson.
Here.
Town Manager McGovern.
Yep.
Student Representative Bolus and Student Representative Rowe.
Thank you. May I have the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Where's Jeff? This is one of the better parts, being chairman. Would Matthew Barnes come up here, please? I'd like to make sure that the cameras can see you properly. Maybe I should stand back to and you stand facing. More important for you to be seen than me. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution. Whereas Matthew Barnes was awarded the Eagle Scout Award, the highest honor of the Boy Scouts of America, at a court of honor on April 9, 2000, and whereas Matt Barnes earned his Eagle rank through meeting rigorous requirements in reaching earlier Scout ranks and in completing over 21 merit badges required to become an Eagle Scout, and whereas Matt Barnes organized his fellow Scouts and completed a significant community service project by cleaning and repairing the battery keys at Fort Williams Park, and whereas the town of Cape Elizabeth is appreciative of Matt's work in improving Fort Williams Park and in providing such an exceptional example of achievement and leadership for his peers, now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate Matt Barnes on having earned the Eagle Scout rank, and we wish him continued success as he seeks to reach other goals and the years ahead. Dated this 10th day of April in the year of 1999 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Congratulations. Would Andrew Clough come forward, please? Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution. Whereas Andrew L. Clough was awarded the Eagle Scout Award, the highest of the Boy Scouts of America, at a court of honor on February 6, 2000. And whereas Andrew Clough earned his Eagle rank through meeting rigorous requirements in reaching earlier Scout ranks and completing over 21 merit badges required to become an Eagle Scout. And whereas Andrew Clough organized his fellow Scouts and completed a significant community service project by working on the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust Hopstone Trail. And whereas the town of Cape Elizabeth is appreciative of Andrew's work in improving the Hopstone Trail and in providing such an exceptional example of achievement and leadership for his peers. Now therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate Andrew Clough on having earned the Eagle Scout rank, and we wish him continued success as he seeks to reach other goals in the years ahead. Dated this 10th day of April in the year of 1999 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Congratulations. I was going to pontificate a little bit on the boys reaching their Eagle Scout, but I think that the boys themselves are the ones to be proud, and we in Cape Elizabeth are certainly proud of them. Congratulations to both of you. Thank you very much for coming. Everybody in the town could see you. Reports and correspondence. There being, oh, Councilor Fritz.
Yes, I just wanted to mention that the regional waste system is having a dedication of the modernization of the recycling facility that's at regional waste system where the incinerator is and all our trash goes for 31 communities. And that is going to be held on Wednesday, May 24th from 4 to 6. And I think it's going to be kind of a fun event as well. And I know the councilors have gotten an invitation and town administration and recycling committee and our public works staff. There'll be tours and you'll be able to see the sorting facility actually operating. And there'll be refreshments and music by a steel band, which is quite appropriate for a recycling facility. So I hope people can come to that.
Thank you very much. Is there any other correspondence reports? Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to give an overview of our last Legislative Policy Committee meeting of the Maine Municipal Association and just let our viewers and people here know that in November there are going to be two constitutional amendments and three citizen initiatives referendums on the November 7th ballot. And I just thought I'd give a little overview of what those are so people can be thinking about those issues as they approach the polls in November and maybe get a little bit more information before voting on them. There are going to be two constitutional amendments. One is LD-2162, allowing persons under guardianship for reason of mental retardation to vote. Actually, that's mental illness. Right now, we do have legislation which allows people with certain categories of mental retardation to vote currently. So that's one referendum. Another one is LD-2422, creating another taxation category. And what this is for current use of land as waterfront land used for commercial fishing purposes. And this would be another way, similar to homestead exemption, of allowing people who have waterfront property that they're currently using for fishing to go with under a separate category of a different taxation and reduce their tax burden. And that's somewhat controversial because it skirts the issue of overall tax reform, which I think several of these issues deal with, but we aren't, as a legislature, we're not really looking at the whole picture. And then there are three citizen initiatives. LD-2349, allowing video gaming at certain horse racing facilities, whereby 40% of the net video gaming income would go to the local government fund. And interestingly enough, the Legislative Policy Committee is opposed to that initiative.
Good.
And LD-2594 is a bill creating sustainable harvesting standard in the tree growth program and requiring permits for clear cuts. And that doesn't affect us too much, but it certainly has great impact in other areas of the state. And penalties for withdrawing from that program have been reduced to just the taxes that would have been paid at the going rate versus the reduced rate. And then the third initiative, and I don't have an LD number on it, is physician-assisted suicide. And those are some of the, those are the five referendum issues that we will see in November. And I encourage anybody who has any concerns or questions about those to contact your legislators in Augusta to get more information, because I think many of them require much deliberation before you vote. Thank you.
Any other reports and correspondence? Hearing none, we'll move on to the town manager's report.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. In the time that I've served as town manager, I've never had the opportunity in 1 month to recognize three employees who are retiring. It's extremely odd for the town of Cape Elizabeth to have a whole lot of employees retiring, but particularly three in 1 month. The first one is David Cousins. David, some of you may know, is the part-time transfer station attendant. He's someone very well known to many, many folks in the community. He's worked there about a dozen years. Now serving the public, helping them out, and couldn't be any more dependable. Just always there, ready to come in whenever we needed him, and he's been a tremendous asset. The second employee is an employee who is currently the longest-serving full-time municipal employee, and that's Bruce Kempton. Bruce has worked for the town effective in March for over 30 years. He's currently holds the position of Parks Foreman, which means that he's responsible for the day-to-day maintenance at Fort Williams Park, all of our other parks. He supervises the summer crew. He also is one of the leaders during our storms in that when we get special call-outs, sometimes he's in charge of the crew. He's just, you know, been a tremendous asset. And I know I think back when Bruce first started the job at Fort Williams, we didn't have the name Park attached to it. It was just Fort Williams. And it's as a result of Bruce's care for and actually love for Fort Williams that it really has become Fort Williams Park. Bruce, though, will not be too sorely missed. The reason that is that he's taking Dave Cousins' place as the part-time transfer station attendant. He applied for the job, and that was one of the issues when he knew that job was available. He applied for it, and Bob Malley hired him for that position, announced it today. So while Bruce is leaving one position after 30 years and is retiring, he will still be working with us. And in fact, I think citizens will get to know him more now than many of them have in the past. He's certainly someone that a lot of folks know, but Bruce has been just a tremendous employee for the town. And I know Bob looks forward to seeing a lot more of him as well as he's up at the transfer station. The third employee is obviously our chief of police, David Pickering, who will be retiring at the end of the month. The department heads had a very nice luncheon just with David today at the Inn by the Sea. It was our last regularly scheduled department head meeting, and it was a very nice event. And some have asked, is there going to be any public event for David? And the Cape Elizabeth Police Benevolent Association is planning something. It's probably not going to be until the summer sometime, but everyone will be informed of when that is. But I spoke last month of David at this meeting, and obviously he'll be missed as well. So three retirements in 1 month is extremely unusual for the town of Cape Elizabeth. I also asked Bob Malley this evening if he would give you an update as part of my report on where we're with the Gulfcrest project, the public works, the new garage, as well as the ball field. That's been moving along. And one of those things, occasionally I hear rumors that this is happening or that's happening, and I think it's good to give an updated report on a project of this size. Robert was very pleased to come this evening to present this report.
Pleased to report that the project's going very well. I probably saw a picture in the Cape Courier. This past issue, the building really started to take shape. The steelwork's going in. There's a lot of roofing work going on. They're doing the floor in the office area, so it's really coming together as a project. If you have an opportunity, please take a swing up there and take a look at it. There's also work going on the ball fields, clearing and grubbing going on. So everything's right on schedule that we know about. Of course, the contractor is reluctant to give us a date. They need to have us in there by November 15th. I think that hopefully we're there maybe by the end of October or middle October if everything comes together. But they'll be doing some masonry work in the coming weeks and block work. So it's doing very, very well, and everything's right on schedule.
Thank you, Bob. We'll also be opening bids this week for the temporary dispatch center, that small addition that's being added to the current public works garage in order to serve as our dispatching headquarters during the time that the new police station is under construction. That the council had previously appropriated the money for that, and we're keeping our fingers crossed that the bids will come in successful for that. So you may have also read that the planning board gave approval to the new new fire station, renovated public works garage, and also the police station. It was a 5-2 vote. Some of them weren't exactly enamored with the building, but we feel it's going to be a very fine facility, one that will be an asset to the town center, and we appreciate all of the guidance the planning board gave throughout that project. Even though they weren't exactly thrilled by it, a number of changes were made that I think improved the project, and we did have some concern from time to time about some of the expense that when they wanted a change here and a change there. And I explained all the time that the council had said not a nickel more could be spent on the project, but we may have spent 4 cents out of the 5 cents. There were a few changes that we needed to make to accommodate the board. And we'll know ultimately what those cost when we put it out to bid. But there's a little bit more landscaping. There's a nicer plaza in front and some more brickwork. But we're very pleased with the input of the planning board and the fact we have those permits in place. So the projects are coming along just fine. Thank you.
Any questions? Are there any citizens, this is a time when we have discussion of items not on the agenda by citizens in the audience. Is there any items to be discussed? Hearing none, I'll move on to the minutes of the April 10th meeting and the minutes of the April 12th meeting, which are both in your packet for your review. Entertain a motion to that?
I'll move that the minutes be accepted as read by the April 10th and the April 12th meetings.
Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. Item number 22, a public hearing and consideration of adoption of the annual municipal school and county budget. I just take a second to remind people that this budget process has been going on for the last 2 or 3 months, and that we have had opportunity for public input, and the school board has held several of their meetings where there's been plenty of opportunity for public input. And again, this is a public hearing on those budgets. I'll ask now, is there any members of the public who wish to speak on item number 122, which is the adoption of the annual municipal school and county budget? Hearing none, I'll declare that public hearing closed, and the council will now, we have several ways of addressing this particular part of the budget. Also, I think as a way of explanation, which you'll hear because I'll have the motion read, this is for members of the TV audience who may not know, that there are several items on the agenda tonight, and they are all public hearing items. They are all budget items. We have several parts of the budget which are special budgets, such as the Riverside Cemetery budget, or the sewer fund budget, or the museum fund, the income from the museum at Portland Headlight, and the Spurwink Church budget. Those are called special budgets. And I would say to the council that there are several ways that we can do this. We should take up the number item 122 as an item alone, and then taking my counsel from the rest of the town councilors, it is perfectly all right to open the budget, the public hearings for all of those remaining budget items, and they can be passed as a whole. So now we're on item number 22. Council, are there any comments or changes? We'll have Michael do a little introduction to it.
Just the amount that was set for thank you, Madam Chairman. The amount that was set for public hearing was a tax rate of 89 cents, and I believe that amount appeared in the last issue of the Cape Courier. Fortunately, since the time of the last council meeting, the Maine legislature and the governor approved a new budget that I think almost everyone in the legislature believes needed more money for education. Some people, as you know, reading the Courier, voted against it. Some voted for it, but everyone supported it. The issue wasn't more money for education. As it ended up, they increased the state school subsidy to the same amount that it was last year. That has resulted in a reduction from 89 cents to 44 cents, or roughly one half the increase. It's 2.23%. However, at the same time, we did lose $45,000, give or take a few dollars, in the shift on the Portland Arts and Technology School, the center over in Allen Avenue. There has been a change in policy of that, which you had heard from the school board at one of your finance committee meetings. Basically, what has happened was there was, and Pauline can bail me out of this if I go down the wrong road, but there was a circuit breaker in place that was originally going to give us a full $68,000, but because some of those criteria were no longer in place that kicked in that circuit breaker, we're only getting we're getting $45,000 less than that, or a little over $22,000. Pauline Aportria, the school business manager, has had extensive discussions with the Department of Education on that, and based on the law that was passed, that appears to what we get, all we will get. So the good news is that it's gone from 89 cents, or about 4%, down to 44 cents, or 2.23%. The other thing I did want to mention is it's always a long, involved budget process, going back from when the capital improvement plans were first prepared. And I really want to thank everyone for their cooperation through this process. The department heads, I think, really did a good job at putting together information. I was really pleased with the information that the school department shared as part of the process. you know, they, in trying to put the whole thing together, they were very cooperative and helpful. I'm not commenting, it's not the manager's job commenting on the dollar amounts, but as far as the process, it was good, and the information was shared, and I really appreciate that cooperation. I also do want to thank the council, and particularly the chairman of the Finance Committee, Ruth Watson, for the way the budget was reviewed. I know last year there was quite a bit of concern in terms of that there wasn't the in-depth review that there might have been, that there perhaps should have been, and the council had a goal, as a goal this year, had the process of having more in-depth review, and that did happen with a couple of meetings added, as well as I think a lot more requests for information and a lot of things in the background for that individuals were looking at to support different increases or support additional revenue increases, which brought the budget down. So I really want to thank everyone for their cooperation throughout the process, and I'm pleased that the tax rate is the amount that it is, particularly considering all the projects that we've just been speaking about earlier this evening.
Thank you very much. Now, Council, any questions about this? Do you have any concerns? We're ready to approach the motion if that's where you are. Councilor Barry.
I'd just like to ask, I understood about a week ago that the proposed increase was 1.9%. Does this $45,000 make that difference to 2.23%?
Yes, yes, sir.
And that's because of Portland Regional Allen Avenue School?
And that's right.
So, and that was to come from the state?
It was to come from the state.
And the state did not send that back to us?
The state is only sending an additional $22,000, roughly $23,000, instead of an additional $68,000. We weren't the only community to lose out, by the way. There were a number of other participating communities in that system who experienced a similar slight shortfall in what they might have hoped to receive.
Well, one. Approximately $7,000 in the assessment is about one penny on the tax rate. Is that right?
That's right.
Yeah. All right.
Madam Chair.
Councilor Watson.
I just wanted to mention to Councilor Barry that I asked those same questions today. And went so far as to suggest that maybe if there were an attempt to get the additional $45,000 back, that would go to reduce the tax rate. But my
this year?
Yes, yeah. But my understanding is, and maybe Madam Chair Pauline Appropria could talk to us about it, my understanding is that there is no more appeal process, that we cannot not go back and get the $45,000. We have exhausted all avenues to getting that. And if that were not the case, I would be recommending that we add language into this budget that says that when and if we get that money, it would be used to reduce this.
I see no harm with, if I might, Madam Chairman, of indicating that when and if we get that money, it's understood, you know, as long as it's in sufficient time to set the tax rate, that be reflected in the tax rate.
That would be great. I think
if we should
have
language. I can publicly commit to that. What I'd suggest is, you know, if you're so inclined as you adopt the budget as is, right. Because you have to adopt it by May 31, and probably, you know, even if there is more discussion, we get anywhere, it wouldn't be probably before then. But we can still commit, knowing that we're getting that money, you know, it nets out, it, you know, our surplus would be okay and everything else. But we could have that reflected in the tax rate as long as it happened between now and August or so when the tax rate is set.
Okay. I think that maybe we need to have some concurrence on the rest of the council, but I think that's the way I would like to see us go.
Well, we can put that, whoever makes the motion for this can add, although we'll have to clean up the language a little bit after yes. this, can add that so that it'll go on a regular motion. Councilor Fritz.
Do I understand that the school budget was figured based on them not getting this amount of money?
My understanding is the $45,000 is not in their budget. I mean, we're not counting on that $45,000.
Right.
So therefore, it's not reflected in their budget.
Right.
So if we were to get that, we could use that then to reduce the tax rate.
Right.
If we get it in as Manager McGovern has said, in a timely fashion.
And this is separate from the amount we were expecting we might not get from the school funding formula.
Right.
I mean, we are going to get all of that, 200 and some thousand. Is that
yes.
correct?
Separate.
Subsidy stays the same.
Yep.
Right.
Are there any more questions about this part of the budget? I would entertain a motion to move this along.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I move that we, maybe I should read.
Yes, I think you should read the draft motion.
Okay, let me read the draft. I move that the Town of Cape Elizabeth Council orders that we're having held a public hearing on tonight, May 8, 2000, that we hereby adopt the municipal budget for fiscal year 2001 with gross expenditures of $21,446,298 and gross revenues of $6,971,781 with the amount of $14,474,517 to be raised from taxation, and does further fix Tuesday, October 3rd, 2000, and Tuesday, April 3rd, 2001, as the dates upon each of which one half of such tax is due and payable, with interest to accrue upon taxes due and unpaid after each such date at the rate of 10% per annum. In accordance with 36 MRSA, Section 506, the tax collector and the town treasurer are authorized to accept prepayment of taxes not yet committed or prior to any due date and pay no interest thereon. In accordance with 36 MRSA, Section 506A, a taxpayer who pays an amount in excess of that finally assessed shall be repaid the amount of overpayment plus interest from the date of an overpayment at the annual rate of 6% per annum.
That's all. You have to read the list of all those.
Thank you. And I hereby amend that to read, should we receive additional funding of state subsidy to the tune of up to $45,000, that will be used to reduce the tax rate, given it happens within the designated period of time that we can set the tax rate, or something of that nature.
It's very clear to me, and we'll get it straightened out in the proper words.
Yeah, the assessor actually sets the tax rate, so it'll read something to the effect prior to the assessor committing the taxes to the tax collector.
Right. I'll second that.
Thank you.
Fine. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any other further discussion? Councilor Barry.
Well, I was just going to ask, the town goes to a lender to borrow the tax money against the money that are going to come in. Is that correct?
No, the town used to borrow tax anticipation notes. We no longer do. We operate off of cash flow.
Okay.
We've tried to set up our debt service payments so that they come in to do right after tax due dates. And I really encourage the department heads not to buy things until the tax money comes in.
So
not totally successfully.
So the town does not have to pay interest on this tax anticipation?
No, we don't pay
interest. All right. When it said you're authorized to accept prepayment of taxes not committed, you said prior to any due date and pay no interest thereon. All right. If someone pays taxes ahead of the date, then they're not going to get any tax break, right?
They get their interest.
No, if individuals pay, if taxes are due on October 3rd and they pay on September 3rd, we don't give them a discount for paying a month early.
Okay. Right.
Nor do we give them a credit for that interest.
Okay. But right after they're late, they pay 10% per annum.
Right.
Okay.
Okay, Henry?
Thank you.
Councilor McGinty.
First, I'd like to commend Finance Chairman Ruth Watson. She did an excellent job with this budget.
Yeah.
We wouldn't be where we are today if it wasn't for her leadership and her tenacity in trying to get us where we are. My vote in no way will reflect her abilities and her competence. Two issues I have. One, I think that we tried to do too much too soon with all our public safety and public works buildings. We took on the pool, taken on the public works building, the renovation for the fire station, and a complete new police station. I concur with my fellow councilors that all these projects need to be done, but trying to do them all at one time, I think, is bad tax policy, because the burden comes down all at once. And so I would have liked to have seen these projects strung out a little bit further, a better strategic plan so that the tax burden wouldn't come as heavy as it does so soon. Second of all, we attended a, the town council attended a joint school board meeting in January. And at that time, the chairman of the board, school board, and the superintendent gave a presentation regarding teachers' salaries. I left that meeting believing, and I do today, that the teachers needed a pay raise, significant pay raise, to bring them up to parity, or at least parity, with the local market. However, once again, when they entered into their, when they resolved their contract with the teachers, I think they tried to do too much too soon. They front-loaded the pay raises rather than stringing it out over a number of years. They front-loaded that so that, once again, the tax burden falls more heavily now than over the next couple of years. So based on that, those two particular issues, I think always we can always squeeze out a couple thousand here, a couple thousand there. But those two major issues are why we're at where we are, I believe, with this tax increase. So therefore, I will not be supporting this tax increase.
I guess I need to ask a question, John. Haven't been on the council long enough with you to see this from last year, I guess. I don't understand how you can support everything all the way along, and then when we get to the night to vote on it, you say, I don't support it. So I guess I can't figure it out.
I think if you went back and saw my votes, you saw that I did not vote to do the police station.
Uh-huh.
And I did not support the price for the fire station. I think you'll find those. I did support the pool, and that mm-hmm. was because the people of Cape Elizabeth voted for that.
But not the price.
And so I did support those. You know, our fate is sealed with the school board. We don't have any say in how they want to handle their contracts. You know, we get that placed in our lap, and there's nothing we can do about that. So, you know, I just wish that they had done it a little differently, that's all. Mm-hmm. You know, but that's up to them. That's their call. So, but I think you'll find that I did not support all those. As I said, I support them being done, but not in the time frame they're being done, that's all.
Okay. Any other counselors? Councilor Swift Kayetta.
I support this budget as a whole. I also would like to thank Councilor Watson. I think she did a great job of running the process. It was my first time going through the process, and I was impressed with how well it worked. And I was also very pleased at how smoothly the council was able to work with the school board, and I appreciate their efforts also because I think they worked nobly on a difficult budget. I have a different point of view than Councilor McGinty on some of these issues. The public facilities, I think, that he speaks of, I think they really need to be done to prepare Cape Elizabeth for the future. The pool has been a great success. The people voted. They did indeed want it, and I think it's turned out to be something that has been wonderful for the community and will continue to make the quality of life here great, and one of the things that makes Cape Elizabeth stand out as a wonderful place to live. As far as the other facilities, the Gulf Crest Public Works facilities, the new ball fields, the fire station, the police station, these are all projects that really need to be done. Some of those buildings were in sad shape. I think Cape Elizabeth has shown over the years that citizens have shown that we get a great bang for our buck with all our public services. I think our fire department, our rescue people, our police station, police department, and our public works people all do a great job, and I think we owe them a lot of gratitude because they squeeze everything out of a dollar that they can. The new projects that we speak of are reflected in the budget with a 0% increase in the town and county services budget and a 0% increase in the community services budget. There is an increase of just over 3% in the school department budget for the tax rate, supporting that increase. However, I think that we as a community needed to make sure our schools are competitive. I think the school board did the right thing in voting for the new contract, and I applaud them for their foresight because I think we were starting to get a real drain on our good teachers and not being able to attract good new teachers to the system. So I think they did the right thing. I think their 3% increase in the budget, I'm sorry, their 5% increase in budget, which is only reflected by a 3% increase in the tax rate, puts us 11th out of 12 competitive towns, and other towns in this area like Falmouth and Scarborough and South Portland and Portland and Gorham and all the sort of suburban towns around Greater Portland and Cumberland County. I've been following their tax rate increases as far as the school budget goes, and we are the next to the lowest of those 12. So I think the school board's done a really good job, as well as on the town side, and I want to commend the school board as well as Manager McGovern for doing a great job, and I thank them on behalf of myself as well as fellow citizens, and I will support this budget.
Yes.
Madam Chairwoman, I will support the budget also, and I again agree with Councilor Swift-Cayetta that a lot of work went into this. It is a good budget. The Facilities 2000 Committee worked very hard on putting this package of buildings and together. And these needs have been recognized and known for many years, and they were put on hold. One project after another kept jumping in front of it. And the timing is right now, and the manager has done an extremely good job in packaging it in such a way that the tax increase is minimal, and as the years go by, it'll actually show less and less each year, making the burden less difficult on families in town. The school budget, I do agree with Councilor McGinty that I would have preferred to have seen the pay raises phased in over 3 years rather than front-loaded quite so heavily, but they are the ones that must decide what was the best way to do that, and I'll accept the result. So, all in all, I think it's a very good budget and a good tax rate that the citizens should be pleased with.
Thank you. Any other comments? Councilor Watson.
I just would like to thank Manager McGovern and the other councilors for their kind words. And it was a pleasure working with everybody. And this budget was a result of everyone's effort, not only on the council, but also the school board. And I appreciate everyone's involvement. And especially I want to single out Manager McGovern, because when I went to him and proposed a reduction, he was very receptive. Maybe didn't totally like it, but was receptive to my thoughts and suggestions and willing to take a closer look at revenues and expenses. And we were able to come up with a zero municipal side increase. And that is purely, I think, a result of our town manager's willingness to tighten his belt, if you will, in a time where we are taking on many capital projects. And like Councillor McGinty, I wasn't in favor of the fire or police. Not that I wasn't in favor of the fact they needed to be done, but I think there were we had a different approach we would have liked to have seen. But for me, that's kind of water over the dam, so to speak. So the fact that we could put forth this budget with those projects and a 0% increase on the municipal side, I think is to be applauded. I am very proud of that fact. I think we all should be proud of that. And the school board budget, you know, from the very get-go, they reduced $30,000 right off the top. Again, Manager McGovern found $50,000 reimbursement money that was not expected that we again used to reduce the school side budget. The fact that there's a 5% increase, but the net effect is 3%. You know, I applaud the school board for their diligence and hard work, and, you know, to look at the numbers. And, you know, yeah, maybe there are a few thousand dollars here and there overall in the budget that we could have cut, but I can honestly tell you sitting here tonight that I don't know where those would be. I think we got all the major areas that we could squeeze. I think we squeezed them. And I feel very comfortable that we have presented a budget that is responsible, that was entered into very thoughtfully by each and every member of the town council, the school board, and the town manager. And I applaud everybody's efforts. And, you know, I will be very happy to talk to anyone about this budget, because I feel that we have done an outstanding job as a school board and a town council of getting the budget to this point. And I want to thank everybody for their help. It was a job well done that couldn't have been done without everybody's effort and attention and thoughtfulness. So thank you.
Yes.
I would also like to thank Councillor Watson, and I particularly, I think we had a better dialogue with the school board, and I think that was very healthy. And I must say I have to thank the manager as well, because I'm impressed that the manager does keep the municipal side of the budget year after year, so that it's in considerable control, I think. Certainly the budget is larger than I'd like, because we're needing to build facilities, but I've attended almost all of the Facilities 2000 Planning Committee and came to realize that the public safety building was in pretty bad shape, and it had been put off for a long time, partly because the middle school in Pond Cove had to be renovated. Also, on the school budget, I was very pleased to be able to attend the all-day session that the school board had, and had a long visit with the superintendent, and that helped a great deal to understand what the issues were that the school board was facing. And I think that they have some real difficult issues to deal with to keep the budget under control. The salaries have been talked about, and I think we did find ourselves near the bottom of similar communities to Cape Elizabeth, and I think the salaries for teachers are very important for the quality of education that our kids get. I think we also found that in other municipal salaries we were a bit low, and that we were losing some employees, and we were having trouble hiring employees in some areas. I also think the school board has a difficult time, because there are mandates coming at them from the state level and the federal level that come unfunded, and I think that presents a difficult problem. And the school funding formula is structured against us, and we had to fight to not lose money last year. We had to do it this year, and I think we need to be grateful for our Senator Jane Amaral for holding out on the budget agreement in order to get the $200,000+ that we were, I think, entitled to. But we're going to have the same fight again next year and the year after, unless that school funding formula is changed. So, and as was mentioned, I think that the increase was held down compared to other communities in the region. So I think they did a good job. I am a little bit concerned that we're counting on as much revenue as we've had coming in this year, and that the economy will continue to stay at this, you know, pretty good clip. And I think we need to watch the budget and watch where the economy is, and if we are not, you know, if the economy loses ground and we have less revenue coming in, we may just have to cut out some projects so we need to keep an eye on it.
Thank you. Is there any further discussion? There's a motion which has been moved and seconded to accept the budget as proposed. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor? Opposed? One. Thank you. We'll move on to the remaining items on special budgets, and I will open the public hearing and read each budget. If there is somebody to speak on that budget, please tell me. This is the item number 123. This is the public hearing in consideration of a proposed sewer fund budget. Is there anybody from the public to speak on that item? Hearing none, I'll move to item number 124, a public hearing in consideration of proposed Riverside Cemetery Fund budget. Is there any discussion on that item? Hearing none, I'll move to item number 125. This is a public hearing in consideration of proposed Museum at Portland Headlight Fund budget. Is there any discussion on that from the public? Hearing none, I'll move to item number 126, This is a public hearing in consideration of proposed Spurwink Church Fund budget. Hearing no discussion, I'll move on to item number 127, a public hearing in consideration of proposed museum at Fort Williams Park capital fund budget. Anyone to speak on that item? Hearing none, I'll move to item number 128. This is a public hearing in consideration of the Thomas Jordan Trust Fund budget. Is there anyone from the public to speak on that budget? Hearing none, that is it. Those are items. I will now close the public hearing on items number 123 to 128. Thank you, Council. Council McGinty.
Madam Chair, I move approval of those budgets as read, 123 through 128.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
Just yes. One item of discussion.
Yeah.
I just like all of these items because there's less expenditure therein than there is revenue on all of them.
That's a very good point. All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you very much for carrying it on that way. Item number 129. Thank you very much for coming. Item number 129, consideration of receipt of the report of the Cape Elizabeth Historic Preservation Study Committee, and I'll call on Councilor Berry, who is chairman of that committee, to summarize.
As the report indicates, we have met many times from last fall through the winter. We've responded to the charge of the council, which formed our committee, and we followed through with public forums and as set forth in the committee. It was not possible for us to form a tight consensus for an adoption of a particular ordinance. It's very difficult to balance the interests of the community against the private property rights of the individual property owners and come up with an easy solution. And these were difficult problems to wrestle with. I think the members of the community, and especially Maureen O'Mara, as our staff, our a planner for the town, were very helpful. And so we have submitted this final report to the council for such action as the council feels is appropriate, if any. Thank you for the opportunity to serve.
Is there any more discussion on that? Yes, Councilor Fritz.
I just wanted to comment on, although the committee didn't recommend any, you know, ordinances or major upheaval of any kind of thing, I think we really began a very important educational effort on the historic structures that we do have in the community. We had a survey to document which ones were very important, and I think it brought a great awareness of what we do have in the community, and some of the recommendations, if they are carried forth, are more along the educational line, and I hope that we can make some of those suggestions a reality.
Thank you, Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to, as part of this, mention some of the recommendations which I thought were outstanding, and I commend this group for all of the work they've done, the public hearings, and their receptivity to hear what our citizens have said about this, that this is very important, but at the same time, they don't want it mandated. They want it to be voluntary. And a couple of things were...
Councilor Watson, we are going to workshop this before we set it, so you...
Yeah, I just wanted to mention for people who are listening, though, that one of the suggestions was a manual for the homeowners. One would be free consulting services, eligible for 3 to 5 hours of free consultation to be paid for by the town if you wanted to do some historic changes. There'd be a 5-member committee and possibly some tax incentives if so adopted by the council. And you know, I think those recommendations are very appropriate for what we're trying to do on a voluntary basis. So I just wanted to mention that for the people who are at home and aren't familiar with this.
If I might respond to that just very quickly, I think you cannot have an ordinance that is not enforceable. We already have that. The 45-day requirement is has been criticized as having no teeth, and I think that's absolutely accurate. You can only have an ordinance if you have enforceability of the ordinance, and any ordinance on a voluntary basis is nothing more than a personal exercise in what a particular property owner wants to have with his own property. And the educational value to me has been enlightening. I never realized we had Italian and Gothic and all these various I think that an English tutor looks like an A-frame, I don't know, but have really gained a lot of education ourselves on the committee, as well as spreading it among the people who have been involved in this, and we've had public forums, and so these are our recommendations to the committee. But I think if you're going to have an ordinance, you must have a structure, you must have a penalty for violation of the ordinance, otherwise it's useless to have an ordinance. An ordinance must be enforceable.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to move receipt of the report, mm-hmm. and that it be forwarded to a future workshop.
That is correct.
Second.
Moved and second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. It's unanimous. This date will be made public to everybody. This has been an issue of great interest to a lot of people. I think just for a second, I would like to acknowledge the people who worked long and hard on this committee. Councillor Henry Berry was chairman. Councillor Carol Fritz was on the committee. Nancy Masterton, representing the planning board. Amory Houghton, the zoning board, and Jack Keneally. Jane Jordan, the Cape Elizabeth Historical Preservation Society. Connie Jordan, citizen, and Nancy Harvey, owner of historic property. Those people came to a lot of meetings in response to citizen concern about our historic structures in this community. The council takes this very seriously. It was a long, hard work to get to this really very nice report, and we will be setting it for workshop, and we'll make sure that date is available to the public, because it's something that so many people are interested in. Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, I would just add that I believe that copies of the report are available in the town hall for people who are interested.
That is true.
CapeElizabeth.com.
And on the website.
On the web, CapeElizabeth.com, huh? Item number 130, consideration of a request from a citizen to amend the zoning ordinance to permit construction of certain lots which received a state minimum lot size waiver and a local public access waiver prior to August 11, 1999. We have received a great deal of very well-documented information on this item. However, it is not appropriate for us to act on it tonight. It is appropriate to send it to the planning board first. But would you like to say something? Oh, we should have the petitioner first.
Does
Mr. Vose wish to say anything? I'm sorry, it isn't really a public hearing, but we're happy to hear from both people.
Is it appropriate for me to speak for Mr. Vose?
Yes. Who are you, please?
My name is...
I mean, I didn't want you to know.
My name is Tom Tinsman. I'm a resident of the town. I live at 89 Sunnybank Road in Cape Elizabeth. I offered to come up and speak for Paul, having been the previous owner of this lot, knowing some of the history behind this lot and it being a buildable lot when I sold it to Paul. So I just want to come up and share some of the things that have gone on with the lot in the past. To start with, back in 1996, I sold this lot to Paul Vose as a building lot. I had gone through the process of getting the minimum lot size waiver from the state of Maine. We also went through the process of receiving a public access waiver from the town of Cape Elizabeth, and then was told that a permit could be issued for a house to be built on the property. Back in 97, the town went through, I don't know if it was a redrafting of the ordinance, but there were some changes made in 1997. At that time, Paul approached the town to check on these ordinance changes to see if any of these changes were going to affect his particular lot, and was told by the current code enforcement officer at that time that they were not affecting his lot, and his lot was still buildable. So that was the change in 97. Between 97 and 99, there was some areas that need to be clarified by the new code enforcement officer, and he asked for some clarifications. And there was a change made in 1999 that, according to the current administration, makes this lot unbuildable in their eyes. So it's a matter of some changes that have happened since Paul bought the lot that has since made this lot unbuildable. And I believe in talking with Maureen O'Mara and other people in the town that it was unknown that this lot would be affected in such a way. So what we're asking is just for the restoration of the rights to be able to build on this lot that were in place when Paul purchased the lot.
Thank you very much, Tom. Probably we will not be asking questions of you at this particular meeting. Yes, is this Mr. Prentice? Is that
actually,
you?
My name is Jim Haddo.
Oh, yes. I do recognize you.
I'm counsel for mm-hmm. Prentice, who's the owner of the piece of property that's nearby this mm-hmm. spot that's in question. And I just have a couple of very quick points that I wanted to make. First, before you refer it on to the Planning Board, I note that your ordinance says that if you determine that the request is clearly contradictory to established town policy, you may deny the request without further action. And I just submit to the council that if there ever were a case in which a proposed amendment was directly contrary to expressly stated town policy, this is it. The ordinance as it existed in 1995 provided an exception to the minimum lot size requirement for lots that had qualified under the state minimums, and this lot would have then qualified. That was the point of getting the waiver that apparently Mr. Tinsman managed to get. In the 1997 amendments, that exception was eliminated. That was gone. It didn't exist anymore. Whatever conversation Mr. Tinsman or Mr. Bose may have had with whoever, with the code enforcement officer in 1997, the plain effect of the amendments of 97 was to eliminate that exception. The municipal legislative body, this council, spoke in 97. That's what it said. This exception is eliminated. There can't be any clearer statement of town policy than that. And if this council were ever inclined to deny a petition without for a zoning amendment without sending it on to the Planning Board, this would be the appropriate time to do that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I want to bring this forward to the council, and I probably need to recuse myself from voting. I work in the same office as Tom Tinsman, and there could be perceived a conflict of interest. And I just need you to be aware of that and whatever action you wish to take for me to vote or not to vote. But I want it to be the public to be aware that I work with Tom, and I don't want there to be any perception of anything out of order.
Okay, fine. Thank you very much, Councilor Watson. Yes, Councilor McGinty.
Just regarding her recusal request, did you have anything to do with this thing at all?
Not your role? Nothing.
And you don't have any financial interest in this?
Nothing. Absolutely not.
It still seems appropriate that I think you recuse yourself from that vote.
It does?
It does.
She wasn't even there. You weren't even working there when this happened. I don't personally see a conflict.
I don't know any more about the situation than what we're hearing tonight. I don't have any additional information. If I did, I'd be very forthcoming. But I just want to be upfront about this and decide as you will.
In fact, Tom has no further interest, and he sold the property. He doesn't own the property anyway. He's just here to say, give us the historical perspective of what happened through the steps.
That's correct.
He doesn't own the property. If we vote either way, it doesn't affect him.
That's true. Okay. Whatever the wish of the council is what I'll do.
Well, I don't have a problem.
Excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm no expert on law or anything at all, but I could see where he might have an interest. I don't mean a direct interest, but if somebody chose to come back after him and said, well, you didn't really sell me what I thought, you know. So it could get a little more complex than we thought, but I appreciate Councillor Watson bringing this to our attention, and I think it's up to her whether she wants to recuse herself or not.
I mean, it seems I have on the planning board, members of the planning board have stepped down when projects are before their group,
their
you
firm.
Know. Yeah. So it seems then there wouldn't be any question.
Just an appearance thing. Mm-hmm.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to ask for a point of order. Does the town charter not say that the other councillors should decide whether...
Yes, this is a consensus, not a vote, on whether or not you want Councillor Watson to recuse herself or not. So do you want Carol... Do you believe she needs to recuse herself?
I think she feels uncomfortable with the situation. I think she should be allowed to recuse herself if she wishes, yes.
I don't personally have a problem, but Councillor Watson, would you rather be recused from this vote?
No, I will vote, but I don't have a problem, but I just wanted to be very upfront.
No, that's right.
I don't
right.
want there to be any appearance of impropriety.
So. And it's the council's decision to decide whether, you know, if it's okay with you, then I don't have a problem, and I don't know if John McGinty doesn't have a problem. Do you have a problem? Do you have a problem?
I don't have a problem.
But you still have a problem?
If Carol does, I will recuse myself. I don't have a problem with that. I would rather have everybody agree than not, so why don't I'll just recuse myself.
Madam Chair, it would be of any
excuse me, sir. We have an attorney that represents us in the town, so you cannot give us that advice.
I wasn't going to.
Oh, okay.
All I was going to say is to the extent that it's any of any assistance to you, we certainly don't have any objection to
Councillor Watson.
Councillor Watson participating.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. So the issue is now, as chair, I still recommend to go to the planning board. That is up to the council now to say. Councillor McGinty.
I move that we send this issue to the planning board for their recommendation and consideration.
Second.
Is there any further discussion on that? Councillor, yes. Councillor Fritz.
I still don't understand why. I mean, this appears that it was approved through various processes and that this would be grandfathered. Maybe I'm just really not understanding this. I don't know why it's been turned down now. I don't know if the manager knows.
He's going to speak.
I can answer that question. Whenever you're looking at a development project, you apply for a whole series of permits. And in this instance, a number of waivers and permits were applied for. There was not a building permit issued for a building because there was never one requested. And at this point in time, to my knowledge, there hasn't been a specific plan submitted that is requesting a building permit. However, in discussions that the property owner has had with the building inspector's office, it's made clear that one would not be issued based on the current ordinance. So, you know, while the other earlier permits and waivers, you know, may be in a grandfathering status, there is, in fact, no building permit. So, and that's the operational issue.
I mean, in reading through some of this, it seemed that I saw that the approvals traveled with the land. So I'm still unclear. I have to say that I think it's very bad policy to change ordinances when you have one situation. You don't change ordinances because of that. I think there can be many unintended consequences, and I think there's the proposed wording here would allow for the state to override our local ordinances on sewers and how large an area of sewer, septic systems we require for lots. I just think this is a really bad idea in this form. I don't know enough about this particular situation, but I don't think we should be changing the ordinances blanket for one case. So I will be voting against it.
Michael has a response.
You've raised a couple of issues. One is how widely applicable this would be in as far as the state doing it. If you notice, this only applies to minimum lot waivers and public access waivers. that were approved prior to August 11th, 1999. And those were the state of Maine minimum lot size waiver would have already had to have been approved, and the Cape Elizabeth Public Access waiver would have also had to have been approved by August 11th, 1999. It opens a very, very small window, which I think, gets to your second point, is that we are talking about a very minimal number of lots if this were to be done. Anyway, and the other point I want to make is whatever language would ultimately be adopted, the petitioner can propose whatever language.
Right.
The council determines the final language. The final point is, I know a couple of questions are raising points of, is the interpretation right? The route of appeal, if someone questions the interpretation of the zoning ordinance by the building inspector, is to the zoning board and not to the council. So if Mr. Vos or anyone wish to go that avenue for an interpretation of language of the zoning ordinance, the route is to go to the zoning board.
I think that's the appropriate route. I don't think it's for a zoning ordinance change and sending it to the planning board.
Oh, yes, sir.
Yes, there is, isn't there? Is that one second? Yeah. There's presently a motion on the floor to send this to the, it's been moved and seconded to send this to the planning board. Councilor Barry.
I'd like to ask for research before any final as to how many lots in the town would be affected. I know you're mentioning a minimum window, but I'd like to know the extent of the effect of such a proposed ordinance change.
Before we send it to the planning board for them to review?
Not necessarily,
oh,
but before
okay.
There's any final vote on it.
Oh, yes.
No,
okay.
Otherwise I would not support it.
Okay. Councilor Watson?
Madam Chair, I'm confused as to where it should go. Councilor Fritz says zoning, and yet the recommendation or the motion is planning. Manager McGovern, would you speak to that, please?
I think, Attorney Haddow brought up a point in terms of, referral and when you have to refer it and when you don't. When a petitioner, Mr. Vos is the petitioner here, he has the right under the ordinance to file this. He's required to pay a $100 fee for its review, which he's done. There is an exception, as Mr. Haddow has indicated, that, if you can clearly state that this is in conflict with policy, that gives you an avenue to say no. In the past, the council always has moved on the side of caution and due process. And, if you did refer this to the planning board, that enables that due process to go forward. There is nothing to prohibit Mr. Vos from also asking for an opinion in writing from the building inspector that he could then appeal within the appropriate period to the Zoning Board of Appeals. So, with all these due process, you do have several avenues available to you.
And that would be the appropriate steps, us to send it to the planning board, if we agreed to do that, and then for him in tandem, if you will, to go to the zoning.
That would be up to him.
All right.
Is there any more discussion on this item? If not, we'll call the question. All those in favor, the vote being moved and seconded to send this to the planning board, all those in favor? One, two, three, four, five. All those opposed?
I'm not voting.
Oh, okay. One abstention and one opposed. Thank you very much. It's a complicated issue, and I hope it comes to a good end for everybody. Item number 131, consideration of setting the opening hours of the June 13th, 2000 primary. The place of election would be at the Cape Elizabeth High School. The time would be from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. on June 13th, 2000. Need a motion?
I move that the town council set 7 a.m. as the opening time of polls for the primary election be held June 13th, 2000 at the Cape High School gym.
Second.
And the closing time be 8 p.m.
Yes, and the closing time be 8 p.m.
Moved and seconded.
I'll still second it.
Thank you, Jay.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Drainage project, and I don't know if you want to speak on this. It seemed fairly clear, but...
It actually is a little bit different. I want to clarify that.
Okay.
The property owner who is being approached on this has been out of the country, not to return until May 15th. It is unusual for us to bring it to the council before the property owners had a chance to review it, but what you'd be doing is agreeing to accept this if the property owner signed it. The difficulty is the property owner has been away all winter in his office, you know, for whatever reason, didn't pass this on to him. However, we want to try to get this project done in time for the road race in August. The difficulty is if we let this slide another month, we could have Shore Road all dug up and not properly back in shape for the road race. So it is unusual that we're bringing this to you, asking you to agree to accept it if it's proffered, but we do not yet have the consent of the property owner whose signature we're requesting on the document. I wanted to clarify that this is unusual in that regard.
I think a motion will have to include words to that effect. Is there any discussion on this item? Councilor Barry.
Has the manager been in touch with the property owner?
No, he's unavailable and won't be available until May 15th.
He doesn't have any representative that you could talk to him? No? Okay.
The Public Works Director has spoken to his office on more than one occasion, and that's been the response. You know, usually when someone travels to the extent that this property owner apparently does, you know, we try to find a way to fax it to them or whatever, but for whatever reason, it hasn't happened.
By mistake.
I don't see how to word it. All right. Does anyone want to make a motion to this? Any more questions?
Can we just say so moved, Michael?
Yeah, what you'd be moving is to agree to accept it if the property owner is willing to provide it.
Well
so
said.
Moved. So moved.
So seconded.
Second.
Well done.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? No opposed. Thank you. Consideration of a recommendation from the Appointments Committee for an appointment to the Recycling Committee. Councilor Swift Kayetta, please.
Thank you. I had to ditch my hard candy there. I thought I was speaking in just a minute. I would like to propose two appointments that the Appointments Committee has come up with. First, for the Recycling Committee, Peter Rich, for a term ending 1-1-2001. And secondly, Michael Tranfaglia for Family Fun Day Committee for a term ending 1-1-2003. They're both well-qualified candidates, and I think they would do a good job serving the town. So I would like to move that we accept these appointments.
Second that.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Councilor Barry?
I think everybody in town has probably seen Peter Rich riding his bicycle up and down Ocean House Road to Portland and back many times at one time or another. And I think it is appropriate to put him on the Recycling Committee.
Play on words, Councilor Barry. Very impressive.
It's an outrage!
Moving the question, all those in favor? Opposed? Thank you, the item's carried.
Can I get a new seat?
At this time, we're going to ask for if there's any citizens that have a discussion of items that are not on the agenda.
Madam Chairwoman, may I speak to that on this issue, or I missed the earlier one?
Which issue? Items not on the agenda? Yes, sir. Absolutely.
I want to beg my apology for being late and... But however, I wasn't goofing off. I was at a farewell dinner for nine folks that were visiting the United States from the Republic of Georgia. And these nine individuals, men and women, were placed with host businesses and host families over the past month, trying to learn free market enterprise as opposed to the socialist type of regime that they were under when they were part of the Soviet Union. It was extremely rewarding, and the Rotary Club does similar type of projects, but any of these programs, if people can get involved in them, I highly recommend it. You'll love it. It's great. No, that's why I was late, and thank you very much.
You're more than welcome. Hearing no discussion.
I had one other point, since Councillor Roberts did mention it. You know, once in a while, councillors will ask me to go out and look at certain projects, and once in a while, I have to do service above and beyond the call of duty, and I usually like to brag, but Councillor Roberts asked me on a recent Sunday afternoon, I forget when it was, early evening anyway, to go out and look at a work that what's Milligan's first name?
Adam.
Adam Milligan had worked some trails over in the Gulfcrest property. They'd put in a bridge, some of the Boy Scouts, and another scout working on an Eagle project. And so he says, Mike, you got to come see this. He brings me out into the woods. And I said, Jack, what's that over there? He said, oh, no, that's not a moose. That's just a stump. Well, there was a 7-foot moose in the woods from about here to where that clock is. And there is, in fact, at least one moose and several in Cape Elizabeth. And if Councillor Roberts invites you to go look at a trail, make sure you know what wildlife might be out there first. So.
Well, I'll tell you, in response to that, I've lived here all my life, and moose was not something that even when there was no houses like there is now, I will say that last summer there were three, a bull and two cow moose, standing on the top of my driveway in Shore Acres.
Oh, my God.
I don't know how they got there. There's not even a body of water near there. So that was an interesting event. At this point, I'm recommending that the council recess in order to work on a strategic plan to have discussion with the rescue unit. We will be coming back we will be in the council forum for one more item, which was to enter into executive session to talk about contract issues. We will not be taking any votes at that time when we do that. The only things that we will be deciding on possibly in that workshop are the dates of workshops. So that we won't even vote on it. We'll just discuss the dates. So at that time, this time, the council will be recessing. We will not be coming back in session. Thank you very much. In televised session. We will be back, but we will not be back in televised session. Thank you very much, and good evening to everyone. Wait a minute. We're not.